Welcome to Strahan Group 71. My name's John Davis and I am director of the Strahan Group. Tonight's event, I think one of the interesting things for me is the idea that what we do, I think, captures just about everything that a university should be. It should be events and outreach, it should be research, and it should be teaching. And within that triangle, I think you find just about everything that we do. And tonight, I think more than most, actually captures this. The event, and we're going to talk about that in a second. But also, this particular piece of historical research, and I think it's an incredible documentary, and I'll go into that in just a second, pops up in our teaching, on our treasury class. And I know that there's new faces in the audience tonight, new audience. And our treasury class, postgraduate, 10-week history of the treasury, will be in its 10th year coming this autumn as part of our new Masters in Government Studies. If you're interested, look at the website, contact us, we're always available. But the next part is the research. And when I received a copy of this when I was writing with John Rentoul, our book on the Blair years reconsidered, I watched this video and went, this is amazing. You know, there's moments in there where, as a student of Peter Hennessy's, we were taught about these incredible magical meetings between senior mandarins and chancellors where decisions would be made. Never did I think that we would see this on camera. It's in this program. An amazing moment where Terry Burns is you know, having a bit of an issue with the brand new Chancellor Gordon. And you can see democracy and the power of, till now, the biggest majority since the Second World War. The power, that political power, and how you get what you want. JR, right on cue. I'm really looking forward to this. I think it's a fantastic combination, as I say, of event, research and teaching. And having put together yet another stupendous panel, I hand over to our illustrious colleague, Professor Balls.
Thank you very much indeed to John. And thank you to all of you for coming along. And a week before polling day, we just thought this was an interesting evening to have, to reflect upon the last time that there was a big transition to a Labour government. And of course, we don't know what the election result is going to be, and we certainly aren't going to preempt it this evening. On the other hand, if the polls were neck and neck, probably quite a few of you would be out canvassing or leafleting or working hard, but there may be some of you here who decided that it's probably okay to have just a few hours off from politics to come and have a discussion about politics and government. And as John said, we're talking here about very unusual documentaries, two films which are shown in the autumn of 1997, one called Out of the Shadows, which documented the final year of the Gordon Brown Treasury team before polling day, and then a second film called We Are the Treasury, which documents the early weeks of the Treasury team, the political Treasury team arriving at the official Treasury. And I think this evening we want to do kind of two things. First of all, to talk about the films and how they were made and how unusual they are, but also the events. And I think obviously the events around this time and their resonance to 2024 and what lessons we might draw from them will be a very interesting conversation to have as well. And we have a brilliant panel because we have, first of all, we have the executive producer of these films for Scottish Television, for STV. They were actually shown on Channel 4, ITV. But they were an STV production, Rhoda McDonald, who's now very senior at Cicero, the public affairs consultancy, but at the time was the executive producer. And we have Ross Wilson, who was the director, and who was the director deliverer of these films. He was like the on-the-ground producer and director of the whole thing was, we all spent very many hours with Ross. He's gone on to do very many great things in television since, but tonight we're talking about these 1997 films. And then we have Baroness Sunai, who's slightly further down, who is in the films, Gordon Brown's political secretary, who had worked for Labour leaders before Gordon Brown, for Neil Kinnock, all the way back to working for Michael Foot and Jim Callaghan. So, you know, and so more than half of the history we cover in our Treasury and Economic Policy Since 1945 class. And Sue was there, came into the private office as Gordon's political secretary, you know, the most pivotal political figure of Gordon Brown's time, both as Chancellor and then as Prime Minister. So he is. So Sue is there as a participant on the political side with me. I'm afraid I'm in these films as well, as you will see. We arrived to be met by the principal private secretary, who had been the principal private secretary to Ken Clark, then became the principal private secretary to Gordon Brown, Nick McPherson, now Lord McPherson, former permanent secretary to the Treasury, now chair of Hawes Bank. Nick and I first met over lunch about 2 months before the general election in 1997, and I arrived at this lunch and he had this big pint of Guinness. Did I think we were going to get on, or did I think he clearly works for Ken Clark? I will allow you to kind of reflect upon that. So Nick is very much in the films. And then, as we'll see later on the very first night, a huge amount of work has to be done because a big surprise has occurred, as you'll see, really takes the Treasury by surprise, and the decision to make the Bank of England independent. And Terry Burns, having consulted with the Treasury Management Board, John Cunliffe, who I think was the deputy director at the time, says, we need to get a young civil servant onto this to work out whether this plan they've got is going to work. And this young civil servant works all through the night, the Friday night after the election, to be ready for the Saturday morning meetings. And it was Tom Scholar, who goes on to become the permanent secretary to the Treasurer via being Gordon Brown's principal private secretary after Nick. Tom was very wise and sort of dodged getting in the film. But Tom is the person who is underpinning the events of that film at the time. And when we get on to the discussion of that transition and how the Treasury was feeling about it, both Nick and Tom's perspective are really interesting. Tom now, former permanent secretary of the Treasury, now chair of Nomura International. And it's brilliant to have Tom here as well. So what we're going to do is we're going to have divide this into segments. First of all, we're going to play some clips which Rhoda will introduce from the first film, Out of the Shadows, which goes up to election night, and we'll kind of give you a little bit of context for that. Then we will then move into the second set of clips, which is about the arrival in the Treasury, those early meetings, bank independence being the focus for the clips which we've shown you. And then we're going to have a bit of a reflection about afterwards about how we feel about seeing this now, what it was like then, and you know, and how it's now appraised. We'll take some questions from the floor, and then we'll end by kind of asking the panel. I mean, it may be that you will prefigure this in the questions, but we'll ask, I mean, about what lessons we all think we draw from this experience, if there is a transition in the Treasury in 7 days' time. So that's our plan for the evening, and then we're going to go for drinks upstairs. And a huge thanks, I have to say, Ross and Rhoda put together these sets of clips. These guys have not seen them yet. I just saw them this afternoon. I mean, it is kind of devastatingly awful. It's so shocking. They chose the clips, and so they're going to take full responsibility for what we're going to see is like a small portion of the film. But just before we actually get on to the first set of films, Rhoda, I mean, it's completely bonkers that Gordon Brown ever agreed to do this. Why, how did you manage to get this off the ground?
I'm not sure he really ever did.
Agree.
Well, I know that Sue certainly knew absolutely bugger
absolutely
all about
not.
It.
Nothing.
The genesis of this project was, bear in mind that at that time, Scottish Television was a minnow in the ITV network, and I was controller of factual programmes at the time, Ross was producer-director, and it was our job to go out there and sell programmes to ITV, to Channel 4, to Sky, whoever. And a couple of years beforehand, our director of programmes then, who was a good friend of Gordon's, had come up with the idea that we would get access to Blair, to Tony Blair. Anyway, it became apparent after a wee while that that really wasn't going to happen. And so we ended up getting access to Gordon by default, or not. And it was really, to say it was hairy would be to put it mildly, because there was nothing in writing. We had these two big commissions from ITV. We'd never been commissioned to make anything like this before. Two in the network first series. I don't know whether any of you remember them. And they were scheduled to be transmitted during the Labour Party conference in September.
After the election.
After the election. And so they were the political jewels in ITV's crown. And all the weight was lying on this poor man's head. I merely had to just make sure he didn't blow the budget. I'm not sure really to this day whether he did or not, but we'll find out. We appeared, and I was there for the first day's filming, and you'll see this in the clip that we're about to show you.
Don't get there yet.
Okay.
Just before you do, so we by this point, this was a year before the election, and so it's probably about, I don't know,
October 96.
What, the very first conversation? As late as that? Oh my goodness, we must have been even more mad than I realised. Gordon says to me and Sue and Charlie Whelan, he says, I've been talking to STV and they want to do, they want to just kind of come and see how things work. And and we said, yeah, okay, thinking like 5-10 minutes, sort of little film. And he says, yeah, I mean, I think it's one film, or maybe two, and we said, well, I mean, you know, I mean, who's in this film? And he said, well, it's really about us, and we said, you know, and have we agreed this with Tony Blair and Alistair Campbell? No. He said, don't worry about that. And then we said, but what are we going? I mean, what is it? And Gordon says, I will never forget this. He said, don't worry. He said, it's just wallpaper. It's just wallpaper. And you thought, so there's going to be 2 hours of wallpaper on primetime ITV. And then from that moment on, let's be honest, Sue, he went into complete denial.
Oh, awful.
He didn't want to be in the films.
No.
And he thought, he didn't really ever believe he'd agreed to it, did he? And so therefore, I mean, it was a total nightmare. You need to get near the microphone.
I was completely bewildered and daunted by this. Here we were, 6 months.
Sue, put it right, much closer to you.
We were 6 months, as we thought, away from an election campaign. Time was precious, and all of a sudden we had to cope with the film crew. Now, obviously, I had to, at some point, talk to Tony's office, and I talked to Tony's office, and trying to explain to them that we were going to devote quite a large section of time to a film that wasn't even part of the election campaign, that was going to be shown after, if we won, after we won, and that it had no relevance to the election campaign whatsoever, and we wanted Tony to be in it, please. So that was slightly problematic, and I can remember having a very tricky conversation with Angie saying, I don't know what you're doing, I don't know why you're doing this, and I don't think we're going to do it. And I said, well, just think, if this film actually does get made and shown, and Tony's not in it, that will be very strange, and you will be cross that you're not in it. So I think you better just cave in and just do it, because it'll work out all right in the end. And that is why eventually Tony was in it.
And then Ross turns up, and you know, with his camera crew and the sound guys and microphones, and says, you know, I need you to be on microphone. And it began to dawn upon us what was going on. If you take the manifesto launch, Charlie and I were microphoned for the whole manifesto launch. Ross was going around with his camera. We had told nobody that we were doing this. every conversation we were having was all being filmed and kind of, but I mean, there was no, I mean, you know, these days I've made lots of documentaries, everybody signs their approval, their release form. I mean, there was, I mean, it was the Wild West, wasn't it? It was astonishing. So it's important when we start this, you understand the context in which this occurs. And let's just say, there was a lack of buy-in.
Yes, you could put it like that. I mean, it would never happen nowadays because, apart from anything else, health and safety would never have allowed us to go everywhere with, I think it was you, Tom, that was saying all you could remember were cables everywhere you went. I think it's also important to say that what was established at the outset, even though we didn't all know each other, was that there had to be a degree of trust. And in the end, that turned out to be quite important. But it was also for us as programme makers important that we were not going to produce a hagiography. We weren't even sure whether we were going to produce anything in the end, despite having shot as much as we did. And although Sue talks about having agreed to persuade Angie to let Tony take part, there was only one scene between Tony and Gordon in the entire 2 hours. There were quite a few scenes of Gordon talking at people on the telephone. Anyway, this scene that you're about to see was the very first day's filming, and we were in Millbank, and Ed was very young, and he was about to brief the shadow cabinet on the economic strategy.
It was a campaign tea, but let's just be absolutely clear. I had no idea that I was going to be briefing them until Gordon turns and says, "Ed, tell them what the strategy is." And I thought, I'm thinking, it's just wallpaper, Gordon. Am I supposed to speak? Anyway, so as you will see, I mean, watch Peter Mandelson's face.
Well, not just Peter Mandelson's face. Hang on one sec. So two characters walked in. Alistair Campbell walked in and said, "What the f*** are they doing here?" Pointing at us. And we're going, "Oh, hi." And Peter came in a minute later and virtually said the exact same words. So nobody knew we were going to be there. There was a degree of antipathy, you might say. Anyway, poor young Ed was there, and you'll see about 30 seconds in that somebody's clearly mumbling about Ed doing this and Ed being filmed doing this, at which point he stops
and Gordon just tells him to get on with it.
The purpose of this meeting is to, first of all, discuss the budget and generally economic strategy in the run-up to the general election. And I'm struck by the fact that the budget is now seen as an almost entirely political exercise on the part of the government. What I'm going to do is ask Ed, first of all, to present this this paper, and then have a discussion about some of the issues arising over the next month.
What I'll just do is run through a few arguments in advance of that, which I think create a context for why we're arguing that things should be done in this way. It's a budget campaign which is effectively a general election campaign. What we don't want to do is be caught in a trap, which is probably a 1964 trap, where you make so much fuss about the state.
Ed Balls was brought in from the Financial Times. He was the young Financial Times Journalist of the Year. He's still under 30. He was brought in to head up our economic expertise. With him, Ed Miliband, who's even younger, who works on the speech writing alongside him and does quite a lot of the political advice and strategy.
Quite simple, really, what we're doing. Except nobody knows we're doing it, which makes it a bit tense.
Gordon Brown and his team have a decision to announce that will make this weekend one of the most important before the election. For a party that feels it lost the last election because of its tax and public spending policies, the question of a top rate of tax of 50% is a difficult one. It's long been argued over, and as yet, no one knows the outcome.
We wanted to assure people about public spending first, and that was the purpose of the Sunday newspaper stories about public sector pay and about public spending.
First of his series of economic speeches, Shadow Chancellor Gordon Brown will show how Labour will implement its save-to-spend approach by announcing a two-year clampdown on public spending.
Well, I guess this is Gordon's major economic speech before the election, and so obviously we've been working on this for
some time now. I mean, obviously, in many ways, it's summing up a lot of what Gordon has been doing over the last 4 years and sort of bringing that to fruition.
Anyway, look, I'm not going to spend all afternoon arguing with you, but if you wrote anything other than we'll be tough on public spending, I'm going to come and beat you up. From day one, Gordon's been killing the spending argument. Now, I mean, if you said a year ago we could get away with not having a new top rate tax, there's no chance, in my view. We've been so successful in being tough on public spending that tax looks after itself. It's public spending is a real issue, it's not tax.
The next thing to do was to announce what the consequences were for tax. So it was a planned strategy, but for a political party, an element of surprise is important when you're announcing decisions.
We're pre-recording everything tonight, so all the morning news bulletins will be all on tough on public spending. And then probably on the Today programme, Gordon will tell them that he's going to announce our tax plans in the speech at 3 o'clock that day. Then the balloon will go up, and then everybody will be desperate to know what we're going to say and everything like that.
I spoke to Jim Naughtie on there.
Once again, Labour intend to use the BBC Radio Morning News programme Today to break the story. That means the other breakfast programmes recording interviews tonight have to be kept in the dark.
The speech is primarily about public expenditure, but you may want to ask him how does it relate to his tax plans, because he may be prepared to say something.
Yeah.
Well, actually, the story we're going to do tomorrow is going to be tax, not spending. And I couldn't have Gordon going in live. And when asked, you know, so today, will you say anything about tax? He can't lie, so... it's just as well get them all over with tonight, really.
So taxes aren't going to go up?
Well, you know, we haven't said that. We'll have to wait until Gordon's speeches.
OK, well, we thought it was going to be this one, because Blair trailed it, didn't he, saying that it's going to be next week?
No, he did.
He did.
Did he?
Well, yeah, he did. He said that,
I don't recall that.
Gordon Brown, he said he wouldn't go any further. He said that until Gordon Brown speaks in his speech next week, that's what he said.
I know, he said in a series of speeches. Saying.
Right, OK. OK. But what about the basic rate of 10p?
Basic rate.
The taxes rate won't go up. They can't go down either, can they? If the spending control is going to stay the same...
I haven't said taxes won't go up. I've said Gordon will ask as Gordon will announce this in his speeches.
What did you just say to me? You just said taxes...
I said Gordon, not Tony Gordon.
Nobody wants to see taxes go up.
Of course not. Everybody wants to pay less tax.
They won't go up. OK, so nobody wants higher taxes, but you accept that they may have to go up.
Well, I didn't say that either. I said you have to wait until Gordon's speech.
First of all, just put your name and title on tape so we've got a bit of level.
Gordon Brown. MP.
MP. OK, Gordon, this speech later today, what is your main message?
That we've got to keep the public finances in order, and to do that we must have the most careful choice of priorities. And I'm not going to make promises that I cannot keep, and I'm going to keep the promises that I make.
It started early on in the day, because earlier on I got a call from Charlie saying, you know, Gordon's doing a round of interviews and briefing the papers very heavily this afternoon. They're going to go really big on it. They're going to splash in the papers. So everybody gets sort of excited about the story. And before you know it, you're sort of on, doing exactly what they want you to do, which is running after this tale. And then you suddenly sit back and you think, well, actually, there's nothing new here. And if I were to say to Charlie, I think I did there, I would ask about tax and say, come on, Charlie, come on, isn't it time that Gordon started talking about tax? Then you'd have the bluster back from Charlie. Oh, don't be ridiculous, Sean. You know, nobody's running that story. Nobody's expecting that.
No, you just have to be economical with the truth. So you have to say things like, Gordon will make them one of his speeches. I'm not going to tell you that. You should never lie, but it's very difficult. But they understand. They'll all understand tomorrow, and forgive me.
We've been promised that Gordon's going to be talking, unveiling his tax plans, but it still isn't going to come, and that's why I think Charlie's actually being so hard at pressing the story about no extra spending, no more public spending, because I think they want to disguise the fact that we're still not going to hear Labour's tax plans.
It is because of the importance we attach to work, and because people have been dealt such a harsh blow over these last few years, that we will leave the basic rate of tax unchanged, and we will leave the top rate of tax unchanged. What I want to do over time, when resources become available, is introduce what is absolutely vital for the low paid in this country in particular, but to benefit of everyone, a 10p starting rate of tax.
Let's get this absolutely clear. This, at last, is the Brown statement on tax. In your first budget, you will leave the basic rate and the top rate unchanged.
I will be making commitments for our manifesto, which are commitments for a parliament, and the basic rate and the top rate of tax will remain unchanged.
Throughout when the parliament?
Yes.
It's perfect, because it actually was quite...
It was on principle.
Yeah, it was quite sort of hit you, you know, everybody would have leapt out of their seats.
Well, the public spending was a bit around the course.
Yeah, well, I don't know why he went so long, public spending.
Well, he didn't know what we were talking about. I thought he was going to ask me about the windfall tax. I was begging him to do so.
Yeah, well, it was exactly the message we wanted. Brown aims at two-year freeze on spending. Brown backs Tory cash. Labour to pledge two-year spending freeze. Man, we'd be straight on to tax. I mean, they would have been gobsmacked when Gordon said on the day programme, and yes, I can announce no tax increases. That would have thrown the whole of central office into disarray. Now, they've got time to recover, but... To be quite honest, you know, Gordon's got the big speech in the evening, or early evening. It should go really big on all the news bulletins, so far so good.
Brown's tax and spending package announced today will be pulled together in a speech at this London Conference Centre this afternoon. It could well turn out to be the most significant speech of Labour's pre-election campaign, and certainly the most significant of Gordon Brown's political career.
The Conservatives try to claim that Labour will penalise work and success by raising tax rates. Nothing could be further from the truth. And as a signal of the importance we attach to rewarding work, I want to make it clear that I will not increase the top rate of tax.
Over this weekend, the Labour Party have mounted a quite astonishing operation in which they've prepared the ground. A little bit of the stories out in the Sunday newspapers, a little bit dribbled out last night, full morning headlines this morning, but the morning headlines this morning were about keeping down public sector pay. I think, frankly, for a party in opposition to really control the agenda for 3 days is quite an operation. The line about the top rate of tax, that we knew, but we didn't know he was going to announce it today. And the Conservatives, I think, were not expecting that he was going to announce that today. And so it got them, I think, a bit flummoxed. They will really tear into Gordon in the weeks and months ahead to say, he may look like a new modern Chancellor to you, but we know he's the same old Chancellor like any other Labour Chancellor there's ever been. And that's where one of the real battles is going to be fought, around Gordon Brown.
Sue, it's just important, because I'm not sure everybody will quite appreciate. You had fought with Neil the 1992 election. I mean, this tax and spending argument was so kind of deep a challenge.
But it kind of went back earlier than that, if you think about it, because, as you said, I worked for Michael Foot. And, of course, Gordon was elected in 1983, so that was the election he came in on. And you have to remember, in 1983, the Labour Party was still talking about the commanding heights of the economy. So, I mean, there was a long way to go. And then Neil, of course, took over. And in 87, the election campaign, our presentation was great, but actually we hadn't really changed that much. Neil hadn't had the chance to change that much, so we were fighting for second place because of the breakaway of the SDP and the Liberal Alliance. So, and then in 92, we had had the policy review, and Neil had said, you know, elections are won in years, not weeks. We'd had the policy review, and we'd had modernisation, but we had the shadow budget. And whatever you think about the shadow budget, we had a poll lead at the beginning of that campaign, which then went south as the campaign went on. And at one point, we thought it was a hung parliament, but of course, again, it was another disappointment that we hadn't put to rest these shibboleths that existed from the 64 and the 76 government. And so, you know, inflation, devaluation, tax and spend. And so when Gordon and Tony started doing that, taking forward Neil's modernisation post-92, it was all he was working towards, really, was getting to the position whereby you could have a manifesto that gave reassurance so that it was prudence for a purpose, that we could win people's trust, that we would run the economy competently, and that if we did that in the first term and we earned their trust, they might give us a second term where we could then rebuild the economy. So it was part of a big strategy that he devoted the whole of that period to, which was why it was very stressful having the film crew with us.
That's true. I mean, I think that weekend, we thought what we were saying about public spending and the two-year sticking to the Conservative plans was, you know, as big a deal, maybe a bigger deal than what we were saying on tax, even though we knew the tax would end up being the headline. And Ross, you were on the inside of this. What was that? I mean, when you think back on that experience journalistically, what we've seen so far in these films?
It's fascinating. And if you're making documentaries, you want to... It's a process that is and the action that is so fascinating, especially if it's what you don't normally see. And you know that would normally be covered with an interview with Gordon and a couple of and a journalist making his comments. And you wouldn't having this opportunity, and partly because I've made films on all sorts of subjects, and you the same things happen all the time. Is that you're there without actually fully realising why you're there, and secondly, you're an expert for about the next 20 minutes, and then you forget it all, and you move on to the next subject. And but that's the essence of it, of what you're offering that's different and new, the feeling that you can build a story. You were interested in telling stories, and Charlie particularly personified that. But it's taking a piece of action, of a decision, and actually seeing the context out of which it can come, and the feeling that you are being present, and I'm thinking, why am I present here? Because you're not telling, you only tell me bits of the stuff, and I only tell you bits of the stuff. And although we can blithely talk about trust, you are building trust, but trust is something you're more aware of at the end of the day than at the beginning of the day or the middle of the day. And I come down because you think something, you're telling me something's going to happen. I'm thinking, well, what the hell is happening? And gradually I get that picture. And then I go out in the street and we just go straight out and onto the streets. Difficult stuff for health and safety and risk assessment television today. They would not make something like this. Can you imagine what's happening? You imagine it with the current crop that you would, and imagine them giving the access that you chose to give. But it gives a much fuller, richer picture about something, the process where it's allied to something that matters. And that's, you know, there are moments like that when, you know, when you are present and that is the opportunity that you seek. And you can build a story in a very different way than it would normally be done in a news program or a political program. And you're watching the faces and you're hearing what they're saying, and they say it in a slightly different way if they're getting into a lift or than they would do if they were doing a set piece interview. As you could hear, the minute Gordon's doing a set piece interview with Shan, that's the set piece interview you'll hear all the time. It's a little bits off where she's been guided down a particular path, and she never did forgive me for not telling her she was being guided down a different path. And but it's that is the joy, the richness of making. And that was just a very good example. And at the beginning, when you were seeing the faces of Peter and Alistair Campbell, and the kind of visceral hostility. Because I remember being almost pushed out of the room. I'd spoken to Peter Mandelson before about the Tony Blair end, and he was obsessed with the Royal Opera House. There had been a series about the Royal Opera House, which was perceived to be very hostile and very dangerous for the Royal Opera House to do, despite the fact the Royal Opera House said that they were only too glad they'd done it, and it changed their profile and their audiences were up. But that was neither here nor there. And so, I think he just thought we'd chosen Gordon Brown as the back door by which we had got back in again, and which was partly
true.
But you learn often to really ask few questions as well as many questions, because you're building a sense of what's actually happening. And if you want to, as is the modern custom and practice of lawyers, to pin it all down, you're never going to see anything. You know, that you couldn't have signed a document because we weren't fully sure what we would get. Gordon wasn't very sure what he was giving.
We had no idea what was going on.
And that's perfect.
I mean, it's really interesting because it is true that we trusted you. And in the end, 99% we felt that trust was absolutely kind of valid from our point of view. Well, I mean, they're bound to be a 1%, Russ. But you know, if we had done it and knew what it was, then I think we'd have done it the second time in a different way. And the truth was, we didn't really just, you know, it's very raw because none of us really knew what was going on. I mean, Sue and I had no idea what Charlie was saying to you.
No.
At any point,
tried to control it.
I might have tried to control it. But of course, you know, what we're going to move on to now is we then move. I mean, it's one thing to show a close-knit team in opposition. But what then happened was we go into the Treasury. And Nick, do you remember the first time that you, you know, kind of knew? I can't remember whether the first conversation, it would have been me to you and me to Terry, and you to Terry. Do you remember, do you recall first time you knew about this crazy idea?
Yeah, I think you mentioned it when we met, but in a very sort of throwaway way, that, yeah, we've got this.
Did I say it's just wallpaper?
We've got this, pretty much. I think, you know, you'd obviously, that was the learnt behaviour, or the learnt line. That, you know, there's this Scottish TV programme going on, and it won't be, you know, it's not a big deal. Don't know quite how it's going to work in the Treasury. And I just remember thinking, this is going to be really quite weird. I mean, the Treasury is, I wouldn't say it's a secretive organisation, but it's pretty self-effacing. And there's a very good press secretary at the Treasury called Michael Ellam, subsequently. And he had something called Ellam's Law. And Ellam's Law is that if someone's got a picture of you, they're 10 times more likely to run a story about you. And actually, you know, if you made a choice of being a civil servant, it's great, you know, you can really try and influence important things. But the deal is you have zero profile and no one has a picture of you and no one wants a picture of you anyway. So it was definitely weird. And also the other thing which I can remember is just thinking, well, fine. I mean, look, I'm just a secretary, you know. I wonder what the Mandarins, you know, Terence and his friends, how they're going to respond to it all. And I don't know, I mean, I don't know if Terry was ever asked whether he had a choice in this matter. Obviously, if you're civil servants in incoming government, you kind of want to be helpful. So, you know, implicitly, he must have agreed to it. And
I think Terry had said no, we couldn't have done it.
Well, I just wonder whether he ever said yes. I mean, he clearly didn't say no. So I don't know. I mean, it's weird because actually when I was permanent secretary, there was some series on the great offices of state where I can remember discussing this with Alistair Darling, and all the other ones were giving access to the department. And Alistair and I, both being cautious, completely agreed that it would be mad to let these people into the Treasury. And more to the point, you know, the permanent secretary in the other departments gave these long interviews. I didn't give any interview at all. But and Alistair, I think, did an interview. So we reverted to type at that point. Yeah. So this is an extraordinary period. I don't think there's any, you know, there was the odd programme on Ken Clark, but, you know, that was wallpaper. The civil servants were definitely wallpaper. In this instance, you actually sort of see, I mean, the other thing was official secrets. We were discussing really quite what then would have been regarded as really secret. I think issues of classification have changed since then. Yeah. But that's my other worry. I thought, you know, you were discussing your budget. You were discussing Bank of England independence. Mm. And how do we know these guys? You may trust them, but what controls do we have on leaking and so on? So I just remember just thinking this is just seriously risky, dangerous, weird, but may as well go along with it because everybody else seems to want to do it.
So let us see the, I mean, this is just a snippet of the 4-hour film, but we're going to look at two different segments. We're going to second look at the bank independence stuff. But first of all, Ross, I think we're going to start with Arrival.
Yes, yes, we do. But just you were asking about Terry Burns, and I remember getting a call from Charlie at 10 o'clock in the morning. I just got to bed because we'd been at the big party, and he said, you better come into the Treasury because there's an argument going on. And I went in to see Terry Burns, and so it's what he said to me was, I know what you want to do and what you have been doing, but it's not going to work within the Treasury. And he said, you would have to, if you were filming anything in the corridor or in the meetings, you would have to clear with everybody first of all, and they would all have to have signed an agreement first of all. And I said, well, there would be no point. And this is a present tense, and I think the present tense is what really matters, and you'll see it with Terry Burns now, how he speaks. He doesn't speak after the event, and almost all television is after the event now. And it's even, it's, there are reasons for that, because everybody, you haven't built a case for saying yes, you were building a case there to say no. And since I'm one of these people that you talk about, then my job is to try to force the door open if you possibly can, in the interests of, not to gain knowledge that nobody else has, but to allow as many people to understand the context in which decisions and actions are taken. But I said, you can't possibly do it like that. And so we looked at one another, and then I said, well, why don't we not do it the other way around? And I'll keep filming, but you can see it before it goes out. And if you or any of your colleagues are concerned and feel that in some way it's invidious to them or to whatever policy, then I'll take it out. And that was the agreement. Except it wasn't written as that, but I just agreed and I showed it. And I'll never forget showing it when we eventually, because it was a Friday before Diana's funeral and the Saturday, so you were climbing over people to get into the Treasury, because they were all out in the pavements at that point. And I remember showing it, and Terry Burns, I showed it as it happened to him, first of all. And he demurred about nothing. And I said, I knew you would, that's it. It's a mixture of the Stockholm syndrome. I understand what you're concerned about. I'm careful. And we piece it together. And I then remember showing it to you and Charlie and Sue and Ed. And then we got to the end of them. And I'm thinking about my plane and going home and just getting out. And you said, we'll have to watch it again. And I said, why would you have to watch it again? You've just watched 2 hours. No, we've got to watch it again. And this was after I heard you were saying to Charlie, oh, Charlie, you come across very well. You're such a man of the people. And Charlie saying to you, oh, but you're so clever, Ed. And you come across really clever. And I said, well, what do you need to watch it again for? And I think it was you that said this, because I only watched me. And now I have to watch everybody.
We were so scared.
I know.
It was frightening.
It was, but that's the human nature is to say no, yeah. For fear of what, and what you're seeking, and what exactly. You, Charlie, and Ed made, why it was so demonstratively a feeling that we were with you rather than about you. Almost all television is about, it's not with. And was because you were prepared to, at that moment, to come out your corner and say things in a manner that was in the moment, in the present tense. And when you hear Terry Burns speaking about how everybody, if I'd asked them to all stand and cheer, which you're about to watch, then they wouldn't have done it. No. But there's an apprehension here, and that's because we asked that question that moment, not 2 months later. In that moment, and that's what I really like about it.
I think we should go for it, Martin. Let's play the first set.
The thing about the election night was that it wasn't a full stop. You know, it was a more like a colon. It wasn't just a case of, oh my God, we've done it, let's celebrate. It was, oh my God, we've done it, but we're going to have to go into the Treasury and we're going to have to start doing things. So whilst the elation and the excitement was there, there was also the feeling of, okay, fine, now we can go on and do something.
I think that actually Gordon walking up the Treasury, for him, really, I felt for him, for me, it's an old building, but for him it was all that work and effort he's put in for this all his life, really. And for Gordon it must have been something else. It was a great moment.
You know, for us, the Treasury was this building we drove past every day to go to the House of Commons or somewhere else. It was this place which did things which we criticised. It was faceless. To suddenly have all these people there welcoming you was amazing.
I then had a sense of history, that people's expectations were there,
we also knew what we wanted to do, and I think that was a great feeling on the day.
I think I was surprised because there was no official announcement about what time he might be arriving, so it was all word of mouth, and as I say, it was entirely spontaneous. I said to someone yesterday, actually, had I asked them to turn out, they would have probably...
The Treasury is not very given to sort of outbursts of emotion or enthusiasm, and in fact it's a fairly staid, cynical institution. And I was astonished to see all these people sort of standing out in the steps, cheering genuinely spontaneously, and I think it is reflects a sort of wider sense one had on Friday of a sort of a new beginning.
Well, welcome to the Treasury. These are the documents that we would like you to have a look at over the weekend. There are some in pink which are the, for each subject, show the main aspects of them, and then there are details.
I would like to read these immediately. And then would we decide if there were to be further meetings at any points over the weekend? Is that possible?
Yes.
Yeah. We're starting on the assumption that this office will be open on the weekend. I mean, it'd be very nice if we
could. The sense of apprehension in the sense that, in my case, I'd never met Gordon Brown before in my life. Having felt very comfortable with one minister in the form of Kenneth Clark, you know that things are going to change.
This place is open for business. The key people will be available for you to discuss any issue you wanted to discuss with it, so it's totally in your hands.
It is different, and they said people get a bit tense, they get a bit, wondering, are we doing the right thing? What will it be like? How will a new Chancellor respond to this material? So I think everybody are probably a good deal happier now that he's here and that we're able to put the things directly to him.
We're going to... Just a quick pause before we do the bank independence bit. I mean, Nick and I have taught with John and the team, the class for 9 years here, about the Treasury and economic policy. And we've talked a lot about transitions, Nick. And we've talked about transitions where you focus on the policy transition. And in this case, there'd been a lot of focus on policy, although the one thing we hadn't talked about was bank independence, really. But then the second part of it is the style and manner of government, and that is a much harder thing to sort of prepare for, and I think we did pretty well, but it was bumpy, wasn't it?
It was. I think the Treasury in the run-up to 97 was busy refighting the last war, which was 1979, when the Treasury simply didn't understand the policy agenda the incoming Thatcher government was trying to implement, but as a result it missed out on the other important thing, which is the cultural change of a new team coming in, who inevitably, you've just won an election, you've been working really closely in a really small unit together. And also, I think when new governments arrive, they tend to reflect a new generation, and who will have different technical skills. You know, I think, I don't know whether it comes up somewhere in this film, you know, the Treasury Press Office had one mobile phone, I think. It may just have had a pager, but it didn't have very many pagers.
And didn't these guys, any pages?
These guys had all worked really, you know, they grasped communications and had pagers, mobile technology. And
But Nick, on the other side of that...
And also the styles of working.
Before you move on to technology, you're totally right about pages and mobile phones, but none of us had ever used an email for work in any way.
Yep.
None of us had ever sent an email for work because it was such a new technology. The Treasury was actually email-based. We weren't. We used to write speeches and then hand round floppy disks as a way of, and we were so risk averse, weren't we, Sue, about anything being written down because it might leak. So coming into this operation where people kind of made notes and then circulated them round, I mean, it was actually quite scary.
I can remember one meeting where, job of private secretary is listening to phone calls, official phone calls, so the better to communicate the outcomes. And I was in the Chancellor's office, and I can remember Sue hurtling in, saying, they're listening to your telephone. And And so there's this sort of basic sort of culture clash. Treasury, very written culture. Everything's written down. You saw Terry handing over 300 pages of briefing. I'm not sure Gordon Brown ever read any of that. I think Ed probably read it. But and we just didn't get it. We've been used to Ken Clark, who'd been a minister for 18 years. He'd reduced being a minister to a sort of fine art of, he did enough work, but no more. And certainly never turned up before 9:30 in the morning, because he'd usually been Ronnie Scott's the night before. And Gordon turned up at 5:30 on the Saturday. I thought I'd been really brilliant in getting in at 8 a.m. So there are a whole lot of things going on where, you know, if you wanted an answer of Ken, partly because of his broader lifestyle, you wrote it down and he wrote the answer. Gordon would never write an answer to anything.
And if you put things in his box, they never came back.
It was a black hole. There's a weird sort of way that government works where you, on a Friday, you stick a whole lot of secret papers in a red box and you post it. Yeah. And mysteriously, it turns up very quickly, even if you're in Fife the next morning. And Gordon didn't know what it, we told him what to do with it, but he still didn't understand. I think he ended up using a sort of that knife to sort of just rip up the sack. And the other big change from 1997, and it comes back to the close-knit team. And it's true whenever a new government gets in. You've got a really strong team of special advisers. And quite understandably, Gordon Brown, who'd never been a minister before, kind of wanted to work with and through his special advisers. So again, the Treasury found that quite challenging, because the special advisers in the last days of the Clark regime were not, good though they were, you know, they were not critical to the decision-making process. So, big cultural challenges, and it was a problem for me, because people kept ringing up and saying, "Well, what's the answer?" And I said, "Look, I don't know what the answer is." You know, and it was a challenge for Terry, the permanent secretary, because he had lots of senior mandarins kind of wanting to know the answer, and he couldn't tell them either. So. This is just
very interesting.
The issues of transition. And I'd like to think in 2010 we kind of approached both sides of it, but that was different because Osborne had been in Whitehall before. So it'll be interesting to see what happens next week.
I mean, you are right. The prosaic ways of working was hard. Actually, Terry had done a brilliant job on policy preparation. I mean, I think I saw him weekly for a year. We had done huge amounts of conversation about process, a lot of iteration back to Gordon and to Ed. We knew everybody. We were really ready to go. But the one thing which we hadn't talked about, on the day of the election, while polling was going on, I had arrived, met Terry in the street in Whitehall, and given him all of our papers on the windfall tax, all of our papers on capital taxation. But we were so nervous that bank independence, because the Ken and Eddie show had meant in the months before the election, Eddie George calling for an interest rate rise and Ken Clark resisting, that bank independence would mean allowing Eddie George to raise interest rates. And Labour didn't want to be the "we will raise your mortgage rates" party during the general election. So we were just very cautious about it. So that was the one thing we totally withheld, and which is why there's nothing on that in those extensive briefs. And instead, what was done by everybody else over 3 months was done by Tom Scholar in about 14 hours. Can you remember, because we're going to go see this bit of film in a second, can you remember when you first found out about the bank independence decision? Did you know, by the way, at the time there was a film being made of the Treasury transition?
Thanks, Ed. Yeah, as Rhoda said earlier, I do remember cables everywhere. The Chancellor's private office is a rather small place, and particularly in these circumstances of many, many meetings happening on lots of different subjects, one after another, it was completely packed full. And there were these just cameras, cables, and I I do remember somebody saying, what's going on here? And somebody else said, they're filming everything. And, you know, so many strange things were happening at that point that another one didn't really seem to matter. So when did I first know? On the afternoon, the Thursday afternoon, the afternoon of the election.
Thursday?
No. Yes, I didn't know for sure, but Terry called me down to his office to say he'd spoken to you, and he said, there's something going on, I'm not quite sure what it is, but I think they want to look at something to do with the Bank of England. Can you write a paper on it, please? Now, the reason he asked me was because there, and Nick will remember this, sometime before that, I think maybe 6 months, 12 months before that, Ken Clark had asked for a piece of work to be done, I guess a rather theoretical piece of work, but the exam question was, if the government were to decide that the UK should join the single currency, which obviously at that point didn't yet exist, what would need to be changed at the Bank of England to make it compatible with the Maastricht Treaty? So that's quite a complicated question, and it covered quite a number of different things: monetary policy, debt management, bank supervision, all kinds of things. And a small group of people covering each of those areas was asked to do it, and it was all done in conditions of complete secrecy, because I don't think Ken Clark had ever said anything to the then Prime Minister about it. And I, at the time, was working on banking supervision, and so somebody had to hold the pen for sort of bring all the different bits together, and that was me. So we'd done this paper months earlier. We sent it off to the Chancellor, the then Chancellor. I don't know whatever happened to it. Certainly, I'm sure he read it with great interest. Terry, of course, remembered that that work had been done. So he said, can you just sort of dust off that work and get something ready in case we need it? Probably nothing will come of it. So that was on the Thursday evening. The following evening, he called then a meeting of all of the senior people, including John Cundiff, who was the director responsible in that area, and I was there as well. And it was at that point that he said, must have been, I suppose, 7 o'clock or 8 o'clock on the Friday evening, where he said, well, I've just been talking to the Chancellor, and he wants to make the Bank of England independent, and he wants to announce it on Monday, which was all quite surprising.
We should play the film.
I mean, in opposition, we were driving the agenda all the time, and it's even more important to do that in government. You've got to be doing things like independence of the Bank of England.
Right, tomorrow.
What people expected Labour to deliver within 8 weeks of power was their first budget. What Labour had in mind to do first was very different. It was to give the Bank of England independence in setting interest rates, a sea change in policy requiring complete secrecy.
I actually think you should think of not announcing it till it's over.
It would be unprecedented not to announce the meeting until afterwards.
Gordon and I had talked on and off for the last 6 months about whether or not we should move fast on the Bank of England. I don't think you'd ever talk to anybody else other than to Tony. There were times when I thought he was more likely to want to do it and times when I thought he was going off it. And then on Tuesday night, he said, I think we should move very quickly. And he said, and can you draft a letter tomorrow? And so I spent the whole of Wednesday, while the election was being won or lost, writing this letter. But I think on Friday when we arrived and Gordon said, oh, and by the way, I spoke to Tony and we think we should take decisive action on the Bank of England. And I said, shall I get the letter? And Gordon said, yes. I'm not sure if he knew quite at that moment the scale of what we were going to ask them to do.
The first I knew that that he wanted to legislate and do early legislation for this was on that Friday evening when we sat down and discussed it.
Who's writing these remarks for the press conference? You know, because that's quite...
Well, you know, the Treasury are, but we'll have a meeting with their bulls. We'll have difficult questions. The Line, we're doing an article for The Times, one for The Sun.
The Sun back this?
I think so.
If The Sun backs it...
I mean, I'll speak to Higgy. I mean,
Well, why don't we call him in, invite him in to the Treasury and talk to him about it? Why don't we invite a few of the editors in? It's important this gets off to a good start.
Yeah.
You know, it's got to be sold to the public, rightly sold, as a measure that we're taking in the first stages of government, and we've seen how damaging the last few months have been.
I became convinced during...
And when I came to the Treasury and realised that the interest rate should have gone up some time ago.
So we took the decision when you arrived at the Treasury? I mean, I don't think you should attack Clark. The Treasury people saying, you know, do you blame Clark? I said, no, you don't blame Clark. It's not actually his fault, is it? There's an election coming along.
It's a process.
Yeah. John, it's Charlie in Gordon Brown's office. Oh, the Chancellor's office. Now, listen, the 8 o'clock news, I've just told the Today programme, will run that the monthly monetary meeting between the Chancellor and the Governor has been booked forward today to 8 a.m. And the Chancellor will make a statement on the outcome of the meeting at 11 a.m. The only thing I'd say is, you know, not for use at the moment, but Gordon will be saying other things at 11 o'clock, so it's his first public statement since he's been made Chancellor.
And taking all of these considerations into account, I recommend to you this morning a rise in interest rates of a quarter percentage point.
Well, thank you very much, Governor.
Could I perhaps just add a word, Chancellor? I think the worry would be that if we were to move by a half today, and I think the economic case for a half is quite strong now, but if we were to move by a half today and you make the announcement that you're going to later on in the morning, it could send a signal that, we're going to be totally mindless in bludgeoning the economy into the ground. And I mean, I seriously, that would be...
None of us would ever be like that. My judgment, quite frankly, is we've inherited a situation in which, in the absence of corrective action, inflation will overshoot the government's inflation target next year. And I'm being as blunt as that. And I've decided that the right thing to do is to raise interest rates by 0.25%, as the governor recommends. That is the decision that I think should be announced at 11 o'clock today, if that is acceptable to the bank.
Thank you, Chancellor.
I don't think there's any further business that we need to discuss at this meeting. It is a significant meeting, as we've all said, because it will be the last. And as I said at the beginning, it has also been my first.
We could have waited for months. We could have had a consultation exercise, but the right thing to do was to do it immediately. I think the governor was surprised by the decisiveness of the move, but obviously I had to tell him that here were my proposals, and if we were going to move forward, they had to be accepted in total.
Morning, how are you?
We brought the monetary meeting forward without telling anybody at the last minute, and everybody then still thought it was going to be just interest rates. We deliberately hit it as a surprise, because if it's a surprise, it's a bigger story, but it was a big, big story anyway.
The government will continue to set the inflation target, and the bank will have responsibility for setting interest rates to meet the target.
The governor had to be presented with a package and make his mind up and then agree to the package. The bank was getting what it needed to be successful, and we had to ask for what we needed to make that possible. There couldn't be a negotiation.
He didn't say, well, actually, I'd quite like to think about the detail of this before having a complete radical change of the bank.
There is surprise, of course, about the timing of the decision, but surprise, I think, only in the sense that people did not expect it now.
There wasn't really a debate about any of this during the general election campaign. You probably will face criticism that you were sort of slightly economical with the electorate in terms of how you...
I don't think so. We set down the principle in our manifesto. The fact that I had, I think, 45 press conferences as and nobody asked me any questions about that particular point is hardly something that I can be blamed for. I've never hid from people the view that the relationship between the Bank of England and the Treasury had to change. Mm.
Now, you say this is the biggest change in the Bank of England since 1694, bigger than coming off the gold standard?
I said it's the biggest internal reform of the Bank of England for 300 years.
The new
Chancellor Gordon Brown took the city and Westminster by surprise this morning with his decision to radically alter the role of the Bank of England.
I did have to raise interest rates. That was a tough decision to take. And I did have to take a decision that I knew would not be popular in some quarters of my own party about the Bank of England. But it was the right thing to do to set a long-term course for the economy.
We all have been frustrated for ages about not having responsibility, not having machinery to do things. And we've kind of got on despite that. And suddenly there's this whole place who just kind of designed to make things happen. And to do things. It's great.
I mean, Ross, we were talking about the kind of very unusual nature of, in opposition, seeing the sort of unfolding of this sort of the political media dynamic. But I mean, I think in kind of British civil service government history, I'm not sure if anybody has ever had the chance to film something in real time in such a sort of open, raw way.
Yeah.
What was it like at the time? Did you know this was unusual?
No, I didn't think about it in quite those terms. It was you seek to be there at an important moment and to capture as much as you can. And it's easy to say, whenever you're doing observational documentary, people talk about it in terms of 24/7 as if you're, you know, you couldn't possibly be filming that. You're filming little bits that you've got that the opportunity to be there. And I think that it's the opportunity to piece it together as it happens. You know, I think that's what's the delight of documentary as opposed to statement kind of television. I've made films with such odd people, I suppose. That's not quite the description of Prince Charles or King Charles, but I've done things with him or Sean Connery or Stephen Fry. I made a couple of films about his manic depression, and and people always ask you, or Russell Brand for that matter, that's addiction, what are they like? Which is such an absurd question, because these people are filmed so often in so many settings, but they virtually are never heard other than in set piece statements. And that's the value of that kind of film, that you are able to piece it together, you know, like a little jigsaw of this is something of what happened. It's only something, it's little bits, but it's more than what you would normally get, which are the statements of either intent or decision. Mm. And that's the joy of putting it together. And bluntly, that's why God arranged it, that you film and then you edit. Then you come back and edit it and you think things quite differently than what you were. I often come back thinking, God, I've missed this, I've missed that. And the editor would say, you know, you've got so much. And I think, really? And so it's just, it's a bipolar industry. And so I just, you seize the moment. Yeah. And you're doing it with people. And I think that what was very important was your, in that sense, that you were willing to participate. Because this is months after the start, so it's not as if you may have been lured into surprising actions in October.
We had to make the best of it, Ross. and Nick, Tom, Sue, you were all there in those days. My guess is that that's probably the first time Sue and Tom anyway have seen it for a very long time. Nick saw it earlier in the week. When you look back on that now, does it surprise you that Terry didn't want to make any changes? Does it capture how things were in those days? Does it miss the point, or does it get to the point?
Well, I think it's a piece of television. It's remarkably accurate of the atmosphere. It was a time of massive excitement, but also just in the Treasury, a degree of trepidation about how this was all going to work out, and the relationships and so on. And so I think we've only seen some of the programme. This is a rather bad bootleg version on YouTube, which I think has been filmed off of television, where you get just a few more hints of some of the dysfunctions inevitably in, you know, civil service likes to be a Rolls-Royce machine, but actually just the sort of long periods where none of us quite knew what was going on and what was going to happen next and why it was happening. And there were inevitably, you know, again, Charlie Whelan, really impressive at news management. There's a sort of official press office, which occasionally had to sort of pick up the pieces and find all that quite difficult. And you see some of this in the wider programme. I think it took about 9 months to a year for things to settle down into a new way of working, which worked and it was functional, but it was very different from that which existed before the 97 election. And actually, having been through the 2010 transition, you know, there's always a step change when there's a new administration, and the civil service kind of needs to deal with it, adapt, and so on. And it can be quite difficult, especially when the party's been, you know, what you've got to remember about 97, 18 years yep. of Tory government. Terence Burns was appointed by a Tory government. Originally, he was brought in as a, effectively a political appointment as chief economic advisor because he was perceived to be a monetarist. So, you know, this was a difficult transition.
It's interesting. I've been doing kind of talks actually this week with DLUHC civil servants and Treasury civil servants, and saying to them that don't think you write the briefs to be in order that you read them on the first day and then you know what you're doing. The truth is the process of learning about what actually is the policy direction, how you're actually going to think about policy, what will actually be the priorities and the differences, and how do you learn about method, that takes, as you said, at least a year, and maybe longer than that. And the idea that you know it all on day one, I mean, it does take a long time for both sides to understand what they're trying to do and how they work together.
Yeah,
you can't expect that to happen at the start.
I mean, there's some brilliant bit in it where there's some cabinet committee has been set up on welfare to work, and they're just brilliant sessions between the cabinet office officials who are completely puzzled about what Gordon Brown is wanting to happen. And, you know, look, in the end, welfare to work was fine, but there were some difficult meetings, and so it went on.
At that welfare to work cabinet committee, the head of the employment service is sitting there, and Gordon Brown in the cabinet committee says, we need to have the New Deal for young people up and running by the autumn. And Lee Lewis, head of the employment service, says it's impossible for a programme of this scale to be ready in 18 months. It will take 2 years. And then you suddenly realise Gordon Brown thinks, no, it's July. And I want it to be ready in the autumn. And Lee Lewis thought he meant in 18 months' time, and he wanted 2 years. And there is this moment where the kind of the ambition of politics and the reality of delivery, for the first time, completely collide. And the compromise was we had one pathfinder in one part of the country, which started in the first autumn, in order to learn so that you could, by the time you got a year in, you know, a year and a half in, you could then have the whole programme. But because Gordon just wanted to get on with it, but of course it couldn't. I mean, it's absolutely fascinating. Sue, what did you think watching that?
Well, as Nick said, there was a certain degree of rubbing up the wrong way, I think, at the beginning, because we had, well, Gordon had been in charge of election strategy, so I mean, had a roving brief over everything. We'd just come through an election campaign. He'd done press conferences every day. We were a very tight team that had worked together, and I mean, we were battle hardened, but we were match ready by the time we came into the Treasury. But then, I mean, I ended up sitting in the private office because I ended up being the interpreter. So I would say he's cross because of this. It's not cross because of that, but it's cross because that's a very big room, which he hates. I mean, that room was enormous. You know, you had that little bit of seating area at one end, you had that enormous conference table, and then you had his computer at the other end. And he'd be forever bellowing because there was, and the private office was miles at the other end. And I used to joke that I'd get roller skates so that I could kind of, the amount of time that I was running. So we had to kind of, we changed the offices in the end, didn't we? We moved because it just wasn't working. I mean, I had the great fortune of, first of all, sitting next to Nick for a very long time, and then when Tom took over being PPS, sitting next to Nick. And I think what we ended up having was quite a good system of an early warning system between the two of us, so that I could, for all of us, so that we would, I would alert you to the political side of things, and you would say, but the civil service, the bureaucracy side of things, is saying this, and I could then kind of spread the stress out to further down the corridor where the two Eds were, and in the end we got into a way of operating, but it took a little time.
Very good. Tom?
I think it does capture very well the atmosphere. I should say straight away that whereas all the three of you were all in the Chancellor's office sort of seeing everything that was happening, I was just one relatively junior official working on one very specific thing, albeit a very exciting and important thing.
It delivered the permanent secretaryship, Tom.
But one thing you don't get from the film, I mean, you do get from the film, I'm sure, I can't remember it so long since I saw it, but from obviously a clip there focused on the Bank of England, was that that wasn't by any means the only thing that was happening over that weekend, which, don't forget, was a bank holiday weekend. So the election was the 1st of May, I think, wasn't it? And so the bank holiday was the early spring bank holiday. And the Treasury was completely full, as Nick said, with at least the Chancellor there from 5:30 on the Saturday morning. But there was just a rolling pattern of meetings all weekend on the first budget, preparations for the windfall tax on the privatised utilities, welfare to work, the national minimum wage, a whole bunch of really big ticket policy items and reforms. You were sitting right at the heart of it. Those of us slightly on the rim of the wheel got pulled in every now and then to do our thing. And as Nick was saying, the change of culture and approach to the job was very extreme. And that's totally fine. It's the job of the civil service to adapt and work to the elected government. But it can be quite confusing, and in some senses actually quite worrying. So I do remember, as we did those discussions over that weekend on the bank independence, we had a whole series of meetings with you, with Ed Miliband. Really rather few with the Chancellor, because he was doing 15 other things anyway. He asked you and Ed to deal with it. And I do remember thinking, well, there are some really big things that are being decided here, like, you know, the formulation of the inflation target, or whether to have a separate debt management office or not. These are big decisions, which normally you would expect to spend quite a long time thinking about and consult lots of people, and in a sense, these were being decided in minutes, in tiny meetings. And so from the point of view of the official responsible for the advice, you worry. You think, well, have we managed to explain all the issues here? We don't want people to make a mistake. We don't want people after the event to think that they hadn't had time to look at it properly.
No.
Of course, what we did was just, rather as Nick was saying earlier, roll with the flow, just get on with the job. Well, and it was really, I think, that starting from that weekend, the way in which department and the political team learned to work
together. I'll tell the Moira Wallace story. So I didn't see that, and then you come in. On the Saturday morning, we went up to see Tony Blair, who was still not even working in Downing Street. He was working from his house in Islington. Gordon and I went. Gordon and Tony spent most of the time talking about appointments to ministerial jobs. But then Gordon said to Tony, who was sitting on a sofa, so this was the first moment of sofa government, he said, we're going to do the Bank of England, we're bringing the meeting forward Tuesday morning, so we'll make the Bank of England independent on Tuesday morning. And Moira Wallace, who was the Treasury civil servant working in Number 10, said, Prime Minister, this is a decision of great constitutional and economic significance. I suggest we commission a series of papers, establish a cabinet committee, have a process where we reflect upon this over the next month. And of course, she'd have been told to say this by Robin Butler, the cabinet secretary, or whoever. And Tony just said, Gordon, he said, is it all right? And Gordon said, it's fine. And Tony said, then I'm happy. And that was it. I mean, that was the collective discussion of bank independence in the government. Now, it's whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, that is just what happened that day, and because we were doing it quick.
I mean, I
I think the other thing, I mean, the cabinet government aspect was interesting constitutionally. The other thing was, which you kind of get a hint at one point in the film just now, is basically the deal was Bank of England, you're getting independence, but you're doing it on our terms. And beneath the surface, there was extraordinary tension, which poor old Terry Burns was in the middle. He was being screamed at by the governor because the governor didn't want to lose banking supervision or debt management. I can't remember which one.
More debt management, actually.
Debt management, and felt that he was being done over. And Gordon not really understanding why this was a problem, and surely, you know, he should be jolly grateful for being given independence. And things really got quite tense. And I can't remember if it was that issue or some other issue where there began to be quite a heated debate between Terry and Ed. And the interesting thing about that room, it's a very long room, and at the far end, cut out of a wooden panel, was the Chancellor's toilet. And Gordon just couldn't—he just couldn't stand witnessing this argument between Ed and Terry any longer, and went off and hid.
Until we left.
Until we sorted that.
Oh my goodness! Now we said we'd go to 7:45, but which is probably a little bit too long. But if everybody does need to leave, but let's just take a few questions from the room, if you've got any, and then we'll do a final reflection from everybody here about lessons for today. So I definitely see a question here, definitely see one here, definitely see one there. So let's just take, we'll take a batch, and then we'll all have a go at answering them, or some of them.
Steve Schiffer, thanks very much for a fascinating, illuminating discussion of quick decision making. I just wonder where the decision to have fiscal rules fits into this narrative. Was it as quick? Was there more detailed discussion both before and after the election? And what did you make of the final decision that came out?
Yep. Cool. Gentleman here. You have to run faster, mate.
Hi. Yes, David Marsh. I just wanted to build a bridge to the present day, really, in terms of the distinction between then and now. And the three things come to mind. One is the extent to which the press and social media and so on have become that much more toxic now. That must have made people maybe less cautious than they might be now about something like this. Second, the way that the civil service was actually quite helpful, it seems, in helping the shadow officials to go around and see officials in the rest of Europe. The fact that Terry Burns himself was there, you know, for you, Ed, for that year. I don't know whether that would happen today. And the other one is, of course, the Black Wednesday, which had happened 5 years previously, was started to fade greatly because the economy was doing rather well. And this time we have the Antichrist of Liz Truss to brandish as the great voodoo, which has been quite helpful, I would have thought, for the present Labour team. So I wondered if people could just elaborate on those three themes.
Cool. David, could you just pass the microphone over to Kitty there? Have we got one? Have we only got one?
Thanks, Ed. Kitty Usher, sort of leading on from the last question, actually, just reflecting on what the panel learnt from being part of the 97 transition. What advice would you give, A, Rachel Reeves, and B, the Treasury, if perchance she happens to be Chancellor in 1 week and 1 day's time?
Perfect. Pass it down to the gentleman there.
Matthew Lloyd from Queen Mary. I'm working on research from New Labour to Starmerism on economic policy. Just two very quick questions. Ed, do you think that Starmer is more New Labour than New Labour, given the economic policy space and how much they've ruled out from tax? There's lots of comparisons back to 1997 manifesto. Tom Scholar, I was wondering, what would be the lessons in your mind from Trussonomics in terms of the power of the markets and the constraints that we can now see existing?
Very cool. Pass it to the gentleman behind you there.
Thanks. Hi, Alan Bancroft. I'm a PhD researcher of John's. I've just got one question for Ross, which is, what would have happened if Terry Burns had asked you to take stuff out of the programme? Would you have lost editorial control, really?
Very cool. Why don't we just pass it that way? There's a gentleman up there, right there. Can you get it up there, and then that'll be our last one.
in the blue shirt, stand up and look like you want to ask a question. I mean, you may not want to, but if you do, great.
No worries. My name is Harris. I'm currently an undergrad here at King's. My main question is, what similarities and differences do you assume to be within the new Treasury, considering if Labour win the upcoming election? What, I guess, differences or similarities do you think can you observe or can expect?
Very cool. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to break this into two parts. What I want to do is go down everybody and say, what do you think the lesson is from this experience in 97, which we've talked about, for the transition now? So that means that the questions from Kitty and gentleman Dev Harrison and partly David's question will kind of do second. So just to cover off the other questions first. First of all, the question on the fiscal rules, I'll do that. Gordon made speeches in 95 in which he talked about structural change at the Bank of England, but never, and talked about independence actually, but never said we will make the Bank of England independent. But he said in that speech in 95 that we would commit to golden rule, balancing the current budget over the economic cycle, that we would have the debt GDP ratio at a stable and prudent level, and we actually said consistent with the Maastricht Treaty, which was gross debt 60%, net debt 40%. And then in January 1997, we did a speech in which he talked about a three-year comprehensive spending review, end-year flexibility, three-year budgeting. So actually, the fiscal changes, and actually also output targets, the fiscal changes which happened in 97, 98, were in some ways as big as the monetary policy ones, but most of them were in the public domain by election day, and we worked on them in a lot of detail over that year. But I think actually, you asked your question, it was all public and in the public domain. So that's my answer to that one. Ross, tell us the answer to the Terry Burns question. What would have happened if Terry had said no, and how would you have managed that?
Poorly, probably. I think that's the other side of the trust. To be quite honest, I can hardly think, having made films and all, with all sorts of situations and people and institutions, that's it's ever come to that. And when it has, it's been in usually something quite minor. And perhaps that's because, for a start, I'm in the hands of Gordon or Ed or Charlie as to what they choose to say. So if that censoring is there all the time, are you invited to that meeting? Can you go to there? Can you hear? Do you have to leave the room, et cetera, et cetera? So that there's an element of control that will always be there. And on the other hand, the simple answer is that I can't think of it ever happening. And even when in other situations people thought that those parties, when I showed it to Terry Burns, he had no objection at all. But he said, I bet you're going to have a hard time with Ed and Charlie. Nothing could be less...
We didn't change anything, did we?
You know, less untrue. And so it's a subtle thing. It's you are playing a game. You know, this is to do with control and power. And I think it's just... Fundamentally, what drives you on is you're just another bit of the jigsaw that you don't often get a opportunity to see. You get lots and lots of interviews, lots of set pieces, lots of the candidates, prime ministers, in a studio in that particular way. This is an opportunity to hear something slightly different. And I'm sure most people will have picked up in your story there of Tony and Gordon at that moment. There's a decision about the Bank of England, but there's also a context that you're capturing, and that's partly what makes process filming so interesting. You get an opportunity to get the context, and you can understand that little bit more. If you're interested in football just now, I'm sure most people would quite like to understand what in God's name Gareth Southgate is actually doing. And I'm Scottish, so I hope he fails, but you know, it's not. That's the bit that you never see. You know, Gary Lineker will say this, or some Alan Shearer will say that, and the good press will pick up on things, and sometimes the players will say things, and Phil Foden will fly home, and you're judging it from all of that. The one place you're not is with them, hearing the conversations that might give you the insight. And that's fundamentally what journalism's about, and trying to find that. And it's just one more bit that might help.
Very interesting. Keir Starmer, clearly an evolution politically. But I don't think you can say he is New Labour a la 1997 or 2001. I think if you think about the way he talks about public services, it is different. I think the way he talks about class and also about workers' rights, the New Deal for Working People, I think that's different from Tony Blair in 1997. I think he thinks about power in the workplace because of the shaping of his experience as a lawyer representing people in the workplace, whether that's, you know, the McLibel case he's fought or the other cases which he's fought in that space. So I think he's different. I don't think you can say he is a New Labour in some historic way, but he wants to win, and that is a very, very important New Labour attribute. Tom, David and I think Martin were also kind of they were asking how much now does the is there a parallel with kind of Black Wednesday 1992 and its overhang and what happened with Liz Truss and Trussonomics, which shapes the context we're in now?
Well, an awful lot has been written and said about the autumn of 22, including by quite a few people in this room, and I'm not sure there's a great deal I can
don't feel the need to say add, to improve don't feel the need that. To add to anything if you don't want to.
I guess Black Wednesday was a consequence of monetary policy decisions. I don't know, Ed, when putting together you with Gordon, this plan for bank independence, to what extent was that, was Black Wednesday, September 92 in your minds? Or was it more recent events of
I think the answer
monetary policy?
Is hugely. Gordon and Tony were scarred by seeing how what felt like a sensible, prudent, political, economic choice to back the ERM, as John Smith and Neil Kinnock had done in 1989, 1991, suddenly became, you know, such a terrible thing for John Major and Norman Lamont to deal with, and also for them very complicated because they felt they couldn't deviate from the policy. They couldn't be the guys calling for devaluation, but they saw how badly things were going. So I think there was a very strong desire never to be in the position again where you tied yourself hard in credibility terms to something which was absolutely out of your control. And with bank independence, it was the Chancellor's inflation target. Four of the nine people were chosen directly by the Treasury. There was no exchange rate target. There was no monetary aggregates. There was explicit flexibility through the open letter system to deal with shocks. So that, I think that was very shaped by not wanting ever to be in a Black Wednesday 92 position if you could avoid it, I would say.
So I guess looking at the more recent experience on fiscal policy, the September-October 22 episode was a fairly significant departure from previous practice in the Conservative years, starting in 2010. And of course, the OBR, which was an important player in all that, was a creation of the
exactly.
Of the coalition government in 2010. So you, looking at the position the Conservative Party setting out in this election, it's a return to that previous approach, which the Labour Party is also,
Exactly.
So the argument in the election is not about the overall approach to fiscal policy or the overall approach to debt policy, it's about tax and spend.
Exactly. And I think the reality was what we did was an evolution from Norman Lamont's reforms in 1993, and Rachel Reeves is talking about an evolution from the OBR reforms put in place in 2010. And actually, I would say the trust period is an aberration. In general, there has been, you know, a desire for credible flexibility, which is what actually the OBR and bank independence gives you. But before I come to Nick, Sue, can you imagine doing any of this in the way we did it in 97 in the modern era of social media?
No, not at all. It's impossible. I mean, smartphones are just, it's really hard to campaign now anyway, so I mean, this would just have been impossible. I don't envy them campaigning at all in this environment with Twitter, with formerly X. I mean, I just would not want to do it at all. Yeah. In answer to Kitty's question, I mean, you know what it's like to be a new minister. I mean, I would say to the incoming government of whatever flavour, hopefully, obviously, it's Labour. Remember the politics, remember the agenda. I think this showed that if you have a strong agenda, you can set the tone and you can start in a really good way. Two small examples, one not of our government, but a small part of it, is when George Osborne got his knickers in a twist over the pasty tax. Now, that proposal had come to us when we were in the Treasury, and we batted it away because we knew that a lot of people shopped in Greggs and they weren't going to like it. But you've got to keep political control over things, and the Treasury will send up briefs because they like things tidy, and that was a tidying up of tax policy, but it was politically stupid, and George fell foul of that. The second one was when we took VAT off sanitary products down to 5%. I still remember the brief that came up which said you cannot do that because what about other products like shaving cream and suntan lotion? So you have to kind of bear in mind that if you want to drive the agenda, you've just got to say that is rubbish, we can do this. So I would expect the agenda to be set, and it is possible. I think we did it in the end, although it was bumpy along the way. We did manage to kind of work it out towards the end. We got quite good at it before we then left.
And then there was the global financial crisis, yes. And there we are. I'm going to take that, Sue, as being the first contribution to the final lessons for the future. Nick, are the civil service as long-term, as David asked, and helpful as they were in 96, 97? And what is your big takeaway from this for transitions in 2024?
Well, I would hope that there has been some very fruitful discussions and engagement between senior Treasury officials, in particular James Bowler, who actually works alongside a lot of you, so he knows about Labour governments, and the Reeves team. I think there's every chance that will have happened. I think my advice to the Treasury would be: don't just think about the policy; think about the wider culture, optics, how the incoming team like working. They will be a close-knit group too. Will have just won an election, and you've got to recognise that and find quick ways of showing you can be trusted. And the way to do that is to deliver. You know, every government, every incoming chancellor, if they've got any sense, will kind of want to grab the wider government's policy agenda, because it has to be framed in terms of the wider budget process. So there will be a budget. I mean, it could be an emergency budget, they could wait a bit longer, but either way, that will set out the stall for the 5 years, and the Treasury needs to be all over that and inspire confidence. It shouldn't be trying to push the government to tax pasties. At least I think it shouldn't. But ideally, and that's why Bank of England independence was so brilliant, there needs to be an announcement very early on which shows the Chancellor has a grip and wants to move things forward. I mean, in a more prosaic space, Tom and I, back in 2010, you know, Osborne wanted to announce 6 billion of in-year cuts within 10 days or something, and actually getting that right. I mean, it may have been a bit of a massacre for the programmes affected, but actually, from a Treasury perspective, that inspired confidence. And actually, think, you know, again, Tom had some special machine on the fiscal front, which would, like a sort of mincemeat machine,
pinball
machine. Pinball. And And underpinning that was we had three sets of cuts. We had a 30 billion cut, a 60 billion cut, a 90 billion cut. 90 billion cut involved abolishing the Royal Navy. But
an age-old Treasury proposal taken off the shelf.
But the reason we did that was we didn't want to be like 79. Yeah. So I think the other thing is to understand history and draw on history, because if you can do that, if you can just see where it went wrong, where the tensions were, if you can anticipate that, I think you can handle it much better.
Very good. Tom, one lesson for the transition?
Staff turnover at the Treasury is famously high and always has been, as long as anyone can remember. I think something like 15 to 20% a year. So the half life of your average Treasury official is quite short. So that means that there are not that many, I don't know what percent it is, of people in the department who would have witnessed and worked through the change of government in 2010. Now, you might conclude from that if there is a change next week, people are going to find all of that a bit of a shock. I think that would be the wrong conclusion, because in my experience, what Nick has said is exactly right. The thing that's hardest to get right is not the policy change, because if you're a civil servant, your job is to work with whatever policy agenda you're given by the government today. People are just naturally very good at that, and adapting from one government to the next is in a sense second nature. What's much more difficult is to learn the different ways of working, changes of personality, structures, relationships within government. All of that, definitely the more human emotional intelligence side of it, that definitely does take a lot of thought. From the point of view of today's Treasury, the good news there is that changes of Chancellor within the same party are every bit as complicated or difficult as changes of party. And if there's one thing that the Treasury has had some experience of recent years, is changes of Chancellor.
Oh, my goodness. Ross and Rhoda, lessons for now. Would you recommend the current Treasury, politically or officially, I mean, should they just repeat this?
Yes. Absolutely, but they won't. We were really privileged. Really privileged, and enormous thank you to all of you who helped us. Ross particularly, you know, he was the driving force behind it all, and his persuasion, charm and talent is how we ended up with the films that we ended up with. And I know it's a cliche, but the thing about cliches is they're true. We were there and we observed history in the making. And it's a shame that that opportunity will not be afforded, I think, to anyone when there's a change next week, if there's a change next week.
Ross? I echo all of that. The old drug adage is what most you would like institutions to do, which is just say yes. But it's not. I think it's harder and harder. I watched them again because I hadn't seen them for 25 years or more, and I was a taken by the fact that the themes recur. You're watching so many of them today play out. I was pleased that so many of the themes that are attached to New Labour were reflected in the sequences, and I found that, which was pleasing, that you had used the time, let's say, wisely to capture that. But I felt quite depressed that there wouldn't be the slightest hope of getting something like that commissioned now, and because you would never get the access that allowed you to do so.
It's interesting. I mean, it's fascinating to watch it. We were so young,
Glad, or do you regret?
Oh yeah, well, I mean, honestly, I've not gone back and watched it because at the time it was quite searing, but I am glad, and I think it kind of brings it all alive back in my mind. So I think we're all pleased that we did it. Not everybody's pleased that they did it, but I think we're all pleased that we did it. I'm going to add one lesson finally, because I talked about the fact that the transition is a big learning thing. The transition takes a parliament; it doesn't take a day. And both sides are learning the whole time, and they're learning about policy, but they're also learning about culture in the way in which Nick and Sue talked about. I think the other lesson, which is really important, is mutual respect. And by that I mean, and I think we had this, that it's important the civil service kind of respects the fact that these are guys with a mandate who are going to get on and do stuff. Because that is what happens in a democracy when you have a change of election. There's a change. But the mutual respect is that it is the role of the independent civil service to advise and to advise ministers, and to advise ministers as the main source of advice. And if you look back in that period when Nick and I and then Tom and I were working together, that there are no notes on the record to Gordon Brown, for me or to Ed Miliband about policy. We never came in and scribbled on the official Treasury advice. We spent hours in meetings with Treasury teams discussing and working on the advice. But the people who advised the Chancellor were the officials who wrote the advice, and the people who then implemented that were through the private office. And I think if you try and think that, you know, the political operation is somehow separate or superior or in charge, and you displace or undermine trust with the official machine, it's incredibly damaging. And if you can have mutual respect between the ministers and their team and the official civil service, and you're continually building that, that is the best way for the relationship to blossom. And I think we can look back and talk together about things which we did successfully, and we can also talk about the times when there was arguments and difficulties, but I don't think we ever lost that mutual respect when I was in the Treasury. I think that's just really, really important. So thank you to everybody for coming. I hope that was interesting and a kind of food for thought a week before the general election, and you'll all be observing all these different transitions happening if there is a change of government next week in Number 10 and in the Treasury and other departments. And hopefully we've given you some things to think about today. And we would like to ask you to come and have a drink on the terrace at King's. And that's going to mean going up in the lift three floors. But rather than turning left out towards the Strand, if you turn right and go in a straight line, the drinks are at the end of that corridor. And there'll be people to kind of usher you along. Huge thanks to Martin and the team at the Strand Group for doing all the work to make tonight happen, and to John Davis for being in charge and doing what Martin tells him, as always, and in particular to Rhoda and to Ross for all the work they've done putting these clips together, getting the archive together and making it possible to have our conversation, and to the panel, to Sue, to Tom and Nick as well. And I hope you've enjoyed it. Thank you very much for coming.